Hello viewers, today we shall discuss the basics of the cover test. There are basically three components to these tests: the cover part of the cover-uncover test, the uncover part of the cover-uncover test, and the alternate cover test. The cover test gives a lot more information than just whether the person has a tropia or a phoria. It tells you whether the squint is comitant or incomitant based on the comparison of the primary and secondary deviations. It tells you whether the deviation is unilateral or alternating. By performing the test at different distances, the variability of the deviation with respect to distance can be determined. The effect of refractive error and accommodation gives valuable inputs with respect to the effectiveness of glasses in controlling the deviation and the power of the glass to maintain optimum control. Amblyopia can be suspected when analyzing the speed of fixation during the test. And finally, latent nystagmus may be uncovered. The cover test should be performed both for distance and for near targets. The distance target should be a letter one or two lines above the patient's best corrected visual acuity in the worse eye, and the near target should be accommodative. Torchlight is not a suitable fixation target for any distance. Cover testing should be performed both without and with the patient's habitual correction. Make sure the patient's glasses do not have prisms incorporated in them. This could interfere with the test interpretation. After correcting any head posture, with the patient fixating on the target, first note the corneal light reflex. This will tell you whether there is a manifest squint or not. Now, the cover part of the cover-uncover test is performed. If there is a manifest squint, the fixing eye is occluded and the non-occluded eye is observed. It will move to take up fixation. Not moving to take up fixation is rare, and we will discuss this later. Now for the uncover part of the test. The cover is removed and now the previously occluded, that is the just uncovered eye, is observed. One of two things will happen. The just uncovered eye, in this case the right eye, will move to take up fixation, indicating a fixation preference for this eye and therefore a constant strabismus, or it remains deviated, allowing the left eye to be the fixing eye, thus indicating an alternating heterotropia. Thus, in a manifest strabismus, the cover test confirms the tropia and the uncover test tells you the fixation preference. How do we interpret these tests when the eyes appear straight? Since both eyes appear to be fixing, the cover test is performed first on one eye and then the other, always observing the unoccluded eye. If movement of the unoccluded eye is noted, it means a small angle tropia not obvious on casual examination is present. If no movement is observed in covering either eye, either the eyes are orthophoric or a latent squint heterophoria is present. This is determined by the uncover test. In the uncover test, the cover is removed and the just uncovered eye is observed. Movement indicates that the eye deviated due to the break in fusion, and recovery occurred on removal of the cover as a result of fusional vergence. The direction of the recovery movement will tell you whether it is an eso, exo, hyper or hypophoria. Phorias are seen on uncovering either eye, the speed of recovery being equal. However, if there is dominance of one eye, the recovery speed may vary between the two eyes. Absence of movement on uncover indicates orthophoria. The alternate cover test must only be performed after the cover-uncover test, as it is not diagnostic on its own. For example, it cannot differentiate between a phoria and a tropia, but rather shows the total deviation, and it cannot differentiate between a unilateral and an alternating tropia. So why do we do this test? The rapidity of the movements makes small deviations to be easily seen and characterized, One can then go back and repeat a cover and cover test to accurately classify the deviation as a tropia or a phoria. Since the alternate cover test ensures continued occlusion of one eye at all points of time, it can uncover phorias that tend to increase in magnitude with prolonged occlusion, thus revealing the true extent of the phoria. And comparison of the speed of fixation for each eye can give valuable information about the quality of vision and the potential presence of amblyopia in each eye. To perform the alternate cover test, the occluder is rapidly alternated between the two eyes so that at any point of time, one eye is always occluded and the patient is not binocular. The eye just uncovered is observed. The following example is that of exophoria. If you wish to observe the eye behind the cover, you may use a translucent Spielmann occluder, and this is what it would look like. What about the scenario in which there is no movement on cover test in a tropia? The causes can be remembered by the mnemonic blind person is eccentric, where the B stands for blind eye, P for pseudostrabismus such as high or negative angle kappa or nasal bridge abnormalities, I for immobile such as in a severe restrictive strabismus, and E for eccentric fixation. So in order to avoid these fallacies, one should ensure the following prior to performing the cover tests. A good external examination to be aware of possible pseudostrabismus. A blind eye cannot fix, so visual acuity and ability to fix should first be determined. Both eyes should have central fixation. Severe motility defects, including those due to secondary contractures, interfere with test interpretation. In children who do not allow occlusion, the occluder may be placed some distance away from the face. So that's it for today.